As with all mathematical concepts, there are three questions you should ask yourself about Taylor series. The first is, what is it? The second is, how do you compute it? And the third is, what is it good for? Now, we've spent a fair amount of time talking about how do you compute it. We know that you get the nth coefficient by taking the nth derivative of your function at a divided by n factorial, and then you can expand the function as a sum of cn x minus a to the n. So that's how you do the nuts and bolts of how you do Taylor series, but that doesn't really tell us what it is or what it's good for. In this video, we're going to talk about what it is and what it's good for. So the main thing that it's good for is approximating a function with a polynomial. So for example, suppose that somebody asks you, what is e to the 0.1? Well, that's really saying, how does e to the x behave for small values of x? 0.1 is a pretty small number. And you might say, you know what? X is pretty close to 0, so e to the x should be pretty close to e to the 0, and that's 1. And that's, you know, the best you could do if all you knew was the value at the origin. And what you've really done is you've taken this curve y equals e to the x, and you've approximated it with a horizontal line. Now, this is a very crude guess, and the reason is because we didn't use any information except the value at that one point. In particular, we pretended that our function was a constant. We ignored the fact that the function changes. But it does change. And in fact, we know the rate at which it's changing. The rate at which it's changing is the derivative, and f prime of 0 is 1. So you might try a better guess. The better guess would be to track the tangent line, to say f of x is roughly the starting value plus how far you've gone times the rate of change. That's 1 plus x. And a picture of that would look like this. Here we have our curve y equals e to the x, and the line y equals 1 plus x is the tangent line. And we've done a whole section on differentials and linearization that showed us how to get approximate values by tracking out the tangent line. So this is better than just saying, oh, it must be 1. But it also ignores something. You see, when we use the tangent line, we're pretending that the slope will be the same forever. In other words, we're pretending that not that f is constant, but we're pretending that f prime is constant. It isn't constant. And in fact, we know how fast it's changing. The rate at which f prime is changing is f double prime, and at 0, that's changing at rate 1. So you might try a still better guess. You add this extra term that makes the second derivative equal to 1. Except now, the second derivative of this expression is always 1. This ignores the fact that the second derivative can change. And if you throw in a cubic term, you get something whose third derivative is constant. And if you throw in an nth order approximation, our nth order approximation, we take the first n terms of a Taylor series, and this is something whose nth derivative is a constant. So it ignores changes in the nth derivative, but it uses everything we know about the value of the function at 0, the derivative at 0, the second derivative at 0, the third derivative at 0, the nth derivative at 0. And at some point you have to say, enough is enough, that's a good enough approximation. We call this the first n terms of the Taylor series the nth order Taylor polynomial, and that's what we use to approximate the function. So let's go back to the thing we wanted. We wanted e to the 0.1, and let's suppose we wanted to 4 decimal places. Our crude guess was just to say, well, it's about 1. If we took into account the derivative that's using the first order Taylor polynomial, you'd get a better answer. Second order polynomial, better answer. Third order polynomial, better. Fourth, better. The more terms you get, the more decimal place accuracy you have. The actual value of e to the 0.1 is around 1.105170918188... dot, dot, dot. And by just taking a fourth order polynomial, we're already good to the 1.1051708. And okay, the last couple digits aren't quite right. Sorry, the 08 is not quite right, it should be an 09. But we have 6-digit accuracy by using a fourth order polynomial. Okay, so that's evaluating e to the 0.1. You can evaluate other things, like the natural log of 0.8. Well, we know that there's a function, natural log of 1 plus x, that we have a Taylor series for. We derived this Taylor series a while back. And the natural log of 0.8 is just plugging in x equals negative 0.2. It's the natural log of 1 minus 0.2. That's 0.8. So the natural log of 0.8 can be gotten in by plugging terms. And if you just use the crude approximation, the value at x equals 0, you get 0. First order, you get 0.2. Second order, you get 0.22. And the more terms you add, the more accurate you get. Last example is the same idea, except now we're not doing it around x equals 0. Suppose we wanted to know the sine of 50 degrees. Now, whenever you're doing a Taylor series, you want to compare it to a nearby point. You want x minus a to be small. So you want to pick a to be close to x, and you want a to be a point that you understand well. Well, 50 degrees is close to 45 degrees. Or in radians, the 50 degrees is 5 pi over 18. And that's close to pi over 4, which is 4.5 pi over 18. Okay, so we're going to use a Taylor series for sine of x, and we're not going to do it around x equals 0. We're going to do it around x equals pi over 4. So we need the value of the function at pi over 4. That's root 2 over 2. The value of the derivative, well, derivative of sine is cosine, still root 2 over 2. Derivative of that is minus sine. Now we got minus root 2 over 2. Derivative of that is minus cosine, minus root 2 over 2. And the process repeats. The next derivative is going to be root 2 over 2, then root 2 over 2, then minus root 2 over 2, then minus root 2 over 2, then root 2 over 2, then root 2 over 2. You get the idea. So our Taylor series is the value at pi over 4 plus the derivative at pi over 4 times x minus pi over 4 plus the second derivative over 2 times x minus pi over 4 squared plus the third derivative over 3 factorial times x minus pi over 4 cubed, and so on. And factor out the root 2 over 2, and you actually get a fairly nice looking series. And we're trying to plug in x equals 50 degrees. So x minus pi over 4 is pi over 36. And we get the sine of 50 degrees is root 2 over 2 times 1 plus pi over 36 minus 1 half pi over 36 squared minus the 6th pi over 36 cubed plus the 24th pi over 36 to the 4th, and so on. And if you evaluate these numbers, you just take the first these two terms, you're going to get 2-digit accuracy. You take these three terms, through the quadratic term, you get 3 decimal place accuracy. If you evaluate it out through the cubic term, you get 5 decimal place accuracy.